asynchronous processing with Apex in Apex, and Jigar is going to help us today to understand this concept. And this is a really important concept for any developer to understand which route they wanted to write the code, whether it's asynchronous or asynchronous. So without wasting time, Jigar, I'm handing over to you.
Thanks for that, Purushottam. I'm hoping that everybody is able to see my screen. So as Purushottam has already introduced the session, but I'll just kind of reiterate once again, today's session is going to be mainly around asynchronous processing, and we'll decipher what exactly asynchronous processing is. But it is a very important term. And today, so before that, just a quick introduction about me. My name is Jigar Shah. I'm an active contributor on the Stack Exchange and the developer community. I'm a Dreamforce speaker, and I've spoken at multiple global events. Got a couple of certifications under my belt. I'm the co-organizer for Apex Hours and part2code.com. I blog at learnsfdcwithjigar.wordpress.com. JigarShah189 is my Twitter as well as LinkedIn handle. So feel free to reach out to me over these channels even after the program. I'll be more than happy to help. Now, with that being said, just a few housekeeping rules. One of the first things, please ensure that you mute your mic. Don't shy away from asking questions. No questions are silly. The way we do always, follow the same format, keep asking questions and adding questions to the chat window. We have our co-organizers, Purushottam is there, others will join in. So, you know, all of them are going to be available and answering questions. If there are, the questions are not covered by them, please ensure the question will be taken care or addressed in the last 15 minutes of the session. Even if you're running short of time, feel free to post or send out these questions or post these questions in the form of comments on against the respective session, and we will be more than happy to answer your questions there. So with that, today is going to be, apologies, my agenda slide is not updated, but just to give you a quick understanding, today we're going to be talking about asynchronous processing, and we're going to be looking at different artifacts that the Lightning platform or the Salesforce platform has to offer from an asynchronous perspective. We're going to be mainly covering batch jobs and scheduled jobs, and then a few variations of that. We may not be able to focus on future and queueable, but we will definitely try to put in a recording for that so that people can understand that. As usual, once we are done with the concepts today, we're going to be giving you an assignment, and just the way you show enthusiasm, you've shown enthusiasm for all the previous assignments, please continue to do that for these assignments and for the assignments for the sessions that we're going to get that are scheduled as a part of this program. So all this while we have been learning about processing that is immediate. So before we you get bogged down with this particular slide, let's just talk about asynchronous and synchronous processing. So basically, every time we've talked about writing some kind of Apex code, we would run the Apex code, right, in some form or the other, whether it was invoked by a trigger, whether you just did a debug, did it through the developer console, the results were almost instantaneous. I mean, they were all immediate, right? However, with asynchronous processing, the story is a little different. We don't really have the luxury of getting immediate results. Now, you guys might be confused saying that if it is not capable of giving us immediate results, why do we need to understand these concepts? One of the foremost things is, especially in the real world, there are often needs for doing real-time processing, right? Which means performing some calculations or performing some kind of executing some kind of business logic and providing the results instantaneously, but there is also an equal amount of need for doing long running transactions or processing extremely large volumes of data. You know, and when I'm talking about large volumes, it could be a million records, 10 million records, 5 million records. So in such cases, synchronous processing is not the best option because one, it gives a poor user experience. Second, however advanced we are in terms of our computing systems or in terms of Salesforce providing the best of hardware, it is not the right choice or the right solution because one, it gives a poor experience. Second, it increases a lot of wait time. Hence, in order to move away from this caveats of synchronous processing, there is something called as asynchronous processing. So the easiest way to understand synchronous processing or asynchronous processing is this. So let's say if, you know, you were to talk to a person, right? And you would pick up the phone and call the person. The phone rings on the other side. The other person picks up the phone. You ask a question. The person responds. You get back the answer. And then you put down the phone. Your communication is done. So this is typical synchronous processing. However, in asynchronous processing, this is slightly different. So taking the same example, you want to ask a question, you pick up the phone, you start calling the person. Okay, the person may or may not be able to answer immediately, right? So what they would do is, there would somebody, imagine, you know, a robo or an entity who would pick up the phone on the person's behalf, understand your question, but may not give you the answer immediately. Person puts down the phone, right? The person who is actually responsible for answering the question figures out the answer to the question, and then the person, that person calls you back on your number. You know, this is a clear example of asynchronous processing. So this is how you differentiate. Now, if you just replace the people with two different processes or two different systems, and the phone channel through the channel of communication, which is internet or any kind of data exchange channel, either on the platform or outside the platform, right? This is exactly how asynchronous processing works as compared to synchronous processing, right? And with asynchronous processing, there are definitely some advantages. The efficiency is higher, and these processes are truly scalable because they can operate or they're capable of servicing large volumes of data. From a Salesforce platform perspective, asynchronous processing has higher governor limits as compared to synchronous processing. So for example, the simplest limit, governor limit difference between synchronous versus asynchronous processing is that the timeout limit for synchronous processing is 6 seconds versus for asynchronous processing is 12 seconds. So which means that you get a higher amount of time for completely processing the transaction. So that is the one of the fundamental differences, which means that whenever you get a problem statement at hand, you want to really look at this flow chart and say that, are the results really required immediately? And often they are not. So you probably might want to consider the asynchronous processing route as compared to the synchronous processing route here. And there are different tools that the platform gives us to perform asynchronous processing and synchronous processing. So all this while, until the previous sessions, you learned about synchronous processing, and triggers, Apex triggers are one of the tools that the Salesforce platform gives us to ensure that we can perform synchronous processing on the platform. However, the Salesforce platform also gives us some additional tools which are specifically devised for asynchronous processing. And those are some of the tools that we're going to be talking about. So there is something called as batch apex. There's something called as scheduled apex. There's something called as queueable apex and future methods. For today's session, I will be only focusing on batch and scheduled apex. But definitely questions around these are also welcome. We will try to answer and also try to put up a demo in the recording later. So with the knowledge of synchronous and asynchronous processing, let's look at our first tool. Now, let's understand that although we are writing Apex code here, one of the key aspects to understand is these tools are very, very specific to a given type of problem statement. Okay. So although you're writing Apex, these are tools that perform or are the best fit solutions in certain areas. So you know, do not really try to use batch Apex and scheduled Apex as regularly as the other Apex because they are very specific and they offer a very specialized functionality. So let's understand how do these blocks of the puzzle fit into each other. So one of the first things that we're going to, or one of the first tools that we're going to learn about today during our asynchronous processing is going to be batch Apex, or they are also referred to as batch jobs, right? Now let's assume, so one of the governor limits that is there on the Salesforce platform is you cannot retrieve or query more than 50,000 records in a single execution context, right? So this is a governor limit enforced by the platform. However, in the real world, you technically have 50,000 is a very small limit. You could have really large volumes of data. And if you really want to process that kind of volumes, batch Apex or batch jobs are the solution for that. Why? Because batch jobs are capable of processing 50 million records. That's a really large volume of data. Hence, one of the questions that you might want to ask, or while a requirement is given to you, you might want to look at is, you know, one, is this required to be the responses expected immediately? And second, what is the kind of volume of data that, you know, I as a developer writing the program am expected to operate over? Okay. So let's just understand how the batch Apex works, right? It's a very simple concept. So batch Apex are basically jobs that get, so batch Apex are technically termed as batch jobs, right? A job is nothing but an instance of a batch Apex class that gets invoked and then put into a queue, right? And it's called as a batch job queue. You can go to Salesforce and we will see how you can actually look at what is in the queue. But yeah, you can actually see once you invoke a batch job, the job is actually added to the queue and it does not execute immediately, right? Once it has the right kind of resources based on the priority, this complete queuing mechanism is taken care by the Salesforce platform. You do not have any control as a developer on the precedence, right? Based on the availability of the resources and the ordering and the priority, which the platform completely controls, the job is then picked up from the queue, and you know, there is some bit of preparation that the platform does. Now, all this that I'm explaining is what the platform does, but this gives you a better sense of one, how you can use batch jobs, and second, how you can use them to solve your problems or really use them in the real world. So once a batch job gets picked up, you know, there is some preparatory work done. And that is done in the form of the start method. Don't worry, don't get bogged down by the terminologies here. A batch job operates over a specific scope of records, right? And the scope is defined in the start method in some form or the other. How, what, we will just see in the upcoming slides. And the way this entire thing works is the entire scope is then broken down into chunks, right? And each of this part of the batch job, so one batch job could have multiple chunks which are termed as batches, right? And that's the reason why this particular process is called as batch jobs, because the complete scope of records that need to be processed is broken down into intermittent batches. You can definitely specify what the batch size is, and there is a min and a max to it. Minimum batch size is 200 records per batch, and maximum is 2000 records, right? So you can play within that min and max range. But each chunk could either have at max 2000 records and at least 200 records. So once the chunking happens, the processing begins. The processing will happen based on some logic that has been written, and we will understand how to write the logic in the batch apex. But the processing happens, the batches execute, right? And finally, the batch job reaches a terminal state, and it could either be, you know, one of these terminal states right here. Either it could complete, which means there is complete success. Everything that was expected to be processed is processed. Second, you know, let's say you had 1,000 records, for example, and the 1,000 records, out of those 1,000 records, 900 update themselves, or you know, the expected operation completes successfully. However, for remaining 100 out of those 1,000, there were some errors, because probably there was a validation rule which restricted the logic within the batch job to perform what it was expected to do. So in that case, there will be a partial success, which means most of it will be success. However, there will be some which will be partial success. Then there are batch jobs which get aborted, right? Aborted as in a batch job has begun to execute, but somebody manually went and aborted the job or programmatically did that. In that case, the state of the batch job would be aborted. And then last but not the least, there's a complete failure. So you had 1,000 records, none of them got processed. There are errors. In that case, it is a complete failure. So these are the critical terminal states of a batch job, right? And it is very important to have to know these states, because this also helps you troubleshoot and, you know, get some understanding in terms of how the batch job executed, what went wrong, and what succeeded. Okay. Chunking. Let me talk about an important concept in batch jobs, which is chunking, which is nothing but the batches. So how do I decide the batches? So for example, let's say I have 1,000 records overall, which are defined in my scope, right? And I am going to break these 1,000 records into batches based on the batch size that I propose. So assuming that proposing a batch size of 200, right? That means each batch in that job execution would process only 200 records, which means that the overall scope of 1,000 records is now going to be broken down into batches of 200 records each, okay? And each of these 200 records in a batch will be processed independently, right? So this is an important concept. Sometimes you need to understand this in order to ensure saying that, oh, if the volume of the total volume of the records to be processed is very high, then instead of 200, you might want to increase the batch size to 2000, okay? Which is the maximum. By the way, default is 200, just to correct the numbers that I earlier said. Default is 200 records. I could also set the batch size of a batch job to a single record, which is one. That means in every batch, I wanted to be want the batch to process only a single record. So that is also possible, but the maximum that can be processed in a batch is 2000. And 200, which I mentioned earlier, is actually the default size of the batch. So sorry about that. So this is how chunking works. The reason why you want to change the batch sizes are sometimes you explicitly want to ensure that there is only a single record processed, because there are a lot of subsequent processing which can be initiated or which gets triggered once a record with from a batch job is processed. So sometimes that is the reason why we've set the batch size to one, although that's not recommended, because that means that your batch job is going to take a really long time to complete. Okay. Similarly, you know, if you got a really high volume of records to process, having a batch size of one, it takes a really long time. And second, you setting it to 2000 will ensure that means that there are more records picked up in each batch, which means that comparatively the time taken to complete the batch job execution will be lesser. Okay, so this is how batch job batch size can affect the overall processing and the perform of a batch apex job, right? Now, let's look at the anatomy of what a batch apex looks like. All this time we've been talking about it conceptually. Let's just see that of how exactly it looks when you put it on the editor. So a batch job basically is nothing but an apex class, right? And in order to understand this anatomy, I would want you guys to circle back to day two of, you know, introduction to Apex, where you were really trying to understand interfaces, right? And we discussed this concept of interface, which is nothing but a contract where you are, where you require the person implementing the interface, and you basically mandate the implementation of the methods. Right. So in order to write a batch job, you need to implement the database.batchable interface, which is provided by the Lightning platform. Right. And this batchable interface, you also specified what your S object type is. If you don't have a specific type, you can also specify the generic S object type. However, you can also make it a concrete type. Instead of an S object type, you can put it as an account or a lead. In this case, it's lead, so you could also make it as lead. Now, this interface here mandates the implementation of three basic methods, which means that any class being implemented as a batch job should at least have these three methods. So there is a start method, there is an execute method, and there's a finish method. Okay, so the start method is actually where you define the scope of execution, right? And the scope of execution is defined generally via a query, or which basically returns a query locator or an iterable of S objects. So iterable is again a collection. So basically all your collections like lists or sets or maps implement the iterable class, and that is the iterable class generally provides methods which you can override to ensure that you can basically define the behavior of iteration. For example, if I am preparing a list of wrapper classes, and if I say get next element, it should get me the element at an even position. So I can define this behavior provided I implement the my class implements iterable, and that gives me the methods to override. So either I define an iterable or I define a query locator. Typically, when you write a SQL query, the SQL query can return a query locator. So it's not actually the query result set after the query has executed. Query locator is nothing but a handle to the query. So it just tells the batch job, hey, by the way, this query needs to execute, and it'll have so many records that will need to be processed. Okay. So that is the start method. This is usually used for a definition of the batch job, saying that what will be processed, right? The execute method tells us how it will be processed, which means you define the scope. Now, one of the interesting things to understand is in the execution, if I circle back to the original explanation of batch job, where I was explaining there were about 1,000 records and we broke them down into batches of 200 records each. The query look, the start method will execute once in the lifetime of that batch job, right? The execute method will execute the number of times the batches, based on the number of batches that are created based on the batch size that you have specified within your invocation. So for example, circling back to my example, which has that you are processing about 1,000 records and you're breaking it down into batches of 200 records each, which means that there will be five batches, right? 1,000 divided by 200 will be five. And that's exactly, the number of times that an execute method will actually execute, all right? Last but not the least, there is a finish, which is a conclusion. So any kind of completion steps. So after the execute methods finish, your actual core logic that you're writing or needs to be processed, maybe it could be mathematical calculation, it could be data reconciliation of any of that process, generally is called from an execute or is written within the execute method. And once this complete batch job gets over, the finish, before it finishes, the finish method gets called. And that finish method is generally used for any kind of post-processing activities. So let's take an example. You are supposed to count. So let's say you're doing a report and you want to count the number of new lead records that get generated on a daily basis, right? So you're running the batch job once daily, and then you are going to, of course, write some kind of query which will get the lead records. You will have a counter which counts the number of lead records, and then let's say you want to notify somebody, a group of people, or send out an email or put a task or any kind of post-processing activity. All that will really be mentioned in the finish method, right? So these are the typical methods which you need to implement when you implement a database.batchable interface, right? So this is the implementation part. Now, how do you invoke a batch job? The invocation of a batch job is very simple. So if I go and stick, if I look at the example over here, so I have a class which says batch job sample, and the batch job sample, so all I'm doing is creating a new instance of my batch job sample class, which is batch job sample, which is the name of the instance. Batch job sample is a complex type, and I'm doing a new batch job sample, which is I'm allocating memory. And then what I do is I make a call to the database.execute batch method. Now this is a standard method which is provided by the Lightning platform, right? It's a static method. So database is a class and execute batch is a static method. It takes two parameters. There are two variations of this execute batch. One, it can only take the instance of the batch job class which needs to be executed. So that is one variation. The other variation that you see on the screen is it takes the instance as well as the batch size, which means that here I have explicitly specified 200. If I don't really specify, by default, the batch size is 200. However, if I want the batch size to be 1,000, I can actually go and change it over here, and that the batch job will process it accordingly. Okay, so so this is typically how you would go and write up, or this is the anatomy of a batch job or batch apex on the Lightning platform. And this is how you, using this small code snippet, is how you would execute your batch job. Now let's go and quickly, that brings us to our first demo, which is how do you write a basic batch job in Apex, or how do you use that to perform asynchronous processing? So let me just switch over to my Salesforce instance. Okay, give me a minute. Okay. So I'm going to quickly go over to my dev console.
Jigar, your screen is not visible.
Okay, I've shared it. I'm not sure if Is it visible
it's,
now?
It's pretty zoom, so we are not able to see it.
Oh, is it? Okay, let me do one thing. I'm going to stop sharing and share it again.
Okay.
Can you see it now?
No, it's still same. It's like a zoom. The entire screen has been zoomed.
Okay. Okay, let me stop my share and let me start sharing again. Okay. Hopefully you can confirm if it's visible. Okay, can you see it now?
Yes, we are able to see it now.
Perfect. So all I did was I just navigated within my Salesforce instance, and from there I clicked this gear icon and clicked the developer console option here, and that brought me to this developer console editor, right? What I'm going to show you is how do we write a simple Apex class, which basically is nothing but a patch job. So for that, in the interest of time, I've already created some of the code here, and we are going to say new and say Apex class, and then I'm going to put the batch class name. I just wanted to make sure that I put in the right class name. So this is how a simple Apex class, or this is the general template of an Apex class. Now let's make some quick changes and we will walk through the batch job line by line to understand what we have written. Okay, some of these methods here are basically, we might have covered it in the previous, some methods or some keywords which we might have covered in the previous sessions. All right, so typically what I was referring to is this global, right? So one of the important things to note is a batch job always has to be marked as global, right? And the class is always marked as global, which means that it is executable, or it can be executed from outside. Of course, there's a class keyword, and then it's followed by the class name, right? And then there is an implements keyword, and this implements keyword has to be followed by the actual name of the interface which can be used, which needs to be implemented. So in this, because we want to do a batch job, it's going to be a database.batchable interface, right? There's a basic number that I have defined. It's just some magic number. I'm just initializing it to zero over here, right? And then I've written implementations for the start, execute, and the finish methods. So in this case, I'm basically returning the handle to my query in the form of a query locator. So database.query locator is a standard method, right? All you need to do is provide the query. I'm doing a SQL query. It's only that I have this SQL query is actually passed to this method as a string. The get query locator is capable of getting a handle to this complete query. And then what it does is, based on the scope or the result set of the query, the start method will kind of chunk the complete scope based on the batch size, and each scope variable of that execute will have only very specific or specific chunks of the complete query locator result set. All right. So I'm doing a system.debug print, and then writing a simple for loop where I'm assigning, running it from 1 to 5, and just making some changes to this magic number, which is I. And then in the last, I'm printing this finish method, and then I'm printing the magic number to the debug log, right? So this is a typical batch class. Now, instead of this simple logic that I've just showcased for demonstration purposes, you could have really complex logic, or this initiating a call to some other classes and performing some complex processing, right? But this is how a typical batch job is written. So once you do that, let me just make sure I save it. So I'm going to just say save. And everything seems to be okay. It didn't really flag an error. Now, in order to invoke, I either have to do it via some user interface, or I can simply go to the execute anonymous window. And there's quite a ton of information over here, so I'm just going to remove that. And then I'm going to just write my invocation script, which is two lines of code. So I'm instantiating the class on line one, which is batch demo one, which is right here. And of course, then I'm passing that instance to my execute batch method, right? Now, one of the things to notice is what I'm trying to show you over here is there are two variations of the execute batch method. One, which just accepts the instance of the batchable class. The other, which accepts the instance and the batch size. So I'm going to just use the other one just to show you the demonstration of the batch size. Technically, we don't have too many batches because this will only run as one batch, right? So I can just set this to 200 for now or 100. Unfortunately, because of the nature of our demo, we will not have too many batches over here, but let's just see that, okay? Instead of batchable, I'm going to pass BD. BD is basically the instance of the batchable class. And then I'm going to just say execute, right? Typically batch jobs are not directly called like this. We will actually see how they are truly called in the real world, but just for demonstration purposes, if you want to explicitly invoke a batch job, this is how you would do it. So let's go and say execute. And this definitely returns the runs the batch job, but you see that there is nothing printed, which means the batch job has not started. So now, in order to search for the batch job, you need to go to your Salesforce instance and go to the setup window. So once you are within your setup window, go to the quick find and type in jobs. And there will definitely be a lot of different jobs that you can see. Okay, what you need to look for is Apex jobs. So I'm just going to open up Apex jobs over here. And if you see, unfortunately, by the time we reached the screen, the job already got processed. But if you see this, that it showcased a log. So the moment I did a database.execute batch, the batch job did not run. However, while I was coming back to the screen, it already got executed, and you see that it gives you some details. It tells you the details of which class got executed. So we created a batch demo one class that got executed. Also, we see that it shows you the total number of batches. Now, this total number of batches is actually governed by the code that we have written. Now, the reason why there would be multiple batches over here is because I wrote a simple query which said select ID, comma name from account. Technically, this may have returned more than 200 records, right, based on the query. And because we have 200 or 100, let me just quickly check the execute anonymous window. Yeah, it would have returned more than 100 records because we set the batch size 200. That's why, it would have broken it down to two batches. Now let's just make some changes here and see if it's actually changing. So I'm keeping everything same. I'm just changing the batch size to 50 now. And let's see if that should ideally result in the change on the number of batches. So basically what I'm trying to showcase is how you can explicitly control the number of batches or the number of records that get processed in a single batch. Honestly, we're not doing any processing on the records. Okay. So let me just, we're just doing a simple system.debug, but technically in this case, there should be at least three logs where in the executed method should be printed thrice, because now the batch size has been reduced to 50. And because it is more than the earlier result set also remains the same. The way the records will be chunked will be into each batch of which processes only 50 records at max. Okay, so let me do that once again. If I say execute, so the batch job ran. And everything executed, it's fine over here, right? But let me just go back. And so I'm again on the Apex job screen, right? I'm going to just refresh this screen. Now, ideally you have two entries, right? So this was the old entry right here, right? You also see that, you know, there's a terminal status to this. The status is completed, which means that the batch job was completed successfully. And if you see the new entry, which means the second time when I ran the batch job, the total number of batches that got segregated were 3, right? So basically, this is how you can explicitly control the batches. Let's go and see if that got that printed anything to the debug log. Because this these jobs run do not run immediately as soon as I call a database.execute batch. Although it seems to you that, you know, because it is running so fast and there is really less amount of processing, you may get the feeling that it is actually being processed synchronously, but it does take some time in between, right, to process and complete. So it's actually asynchronous processing. Let me go back to the debug console and see if it's printed anything. So this log is from an older execution. This is not for the newer execution. So if you actually see, there were a couple of logs that got generated, okay? And these are the older logs which got generated for the earlier execution. So let's just open these one by one and see what is going on here. So I'm just going to close this just to ensure that, you know, we all don't get confused. I'm going to open each job one by one and see what is happening. So there is, when you look at a log here, it also tells you, you know, what is going on and where, what kind of operation this was. So if you see over here, there was a batch Apex which ran, right? And if I open that log, this was the execution of a batch job. And one of the other things that if you see over here is, you know, each of the method execution of that batch job is recorded separately. Now, if you see over here, this batch job only shows the finish method, right? And there is a magic num 0 which is printed, and I will talk about it in a minute, but just to give you a perspective. Similarly, there is another batch job. So if I open that up, so this is perhaps the start, and then there are a couple of others. So let's just see that. Okay, none. None here. Okay, so there is one execution of the execute method. So if you see that there is a print that has happened, which is in the execute method, right? So ideally there will be multiple entries. So if I go and check, there has to be multiple times the in the execute method statements would be printed, because each time a batch, a chunk would run, or a batch would run within a batch job, the execute method would actually run, and you know, number of times the method runs, the statement gets printed. Okay, so that's exactly what I was trying to demonstrate over here, but you're only seeing one of those, so I'm sure it's got lost in this complete list of logs, but that's how it typically executes, right? And one of the key aspects to also note over here is I created a number which is and I initialized it to 0, right? And this number, I made changes to it multiple times during the execution of the job, right? where I was assigning it some value. However, when the finish method ran and I printed the value of that magic number, the value that you see is gets printed as zero, which means that any kind of changes that you are making to the in-memory variables are not persisted across the batches of the batch job, which means that if this execute method ran twice or thrice based on the batch size that I had configured, there would have been multiple times this method would have executed and it would have actually made changes to the magic number. However, those changes were not persisted to the in-memory variable, which is magic num here. So that's the reason why finally what happens is the magic number here is still the original one, which is zero. Okay, so this was the reason why I actually printed this particular value in the finish method. So this is how you typically or basically write a very simple basic batch job and a batch that's a simple batch apex example. So let me just quickly switch back to my I'm going to run the presentation again. So this is how you simply write a basic batch job, right? And what I was trying to showcase is that the state across the batches is not persisted. And that's the reason why that magic number value was zero. So this could be a problem in situations where, let's say you're trying to check or keep a count of the total lead records which belong to the state of Texas, for example, right? What would happen is in a regular scenario, you would write a query to say, hey, by the way, get me select ID, comma name from lead where state equals Texas. And this could probably return 5,000, assuming that you have a lot of data, it could really return 100,000 records. Now the problem is you could only do at max count 2,000 records. And, you know, based on the batch size, if you set the batch size to 2,000, so 100,000 divided by 2,000, right, which is, I believe it should be 50, if I'm not very, very bad at maths. So 50 times your job will actually execute, but in order to really make a count of that, you would iterate. But every time in every execution method, the batch job, the counter value would get reset and it would not persist. And when they're finally in the finish method, when you would want to notify somebody that, oh, by the way, there are about 100,000 or whatever, 90,000 Texas records which are there, you would not get that value because the state of the variable could not be persisted across the batch job, okay? The batches of the batch job. So in order to overcome this particular challenge, you have another interface that Apex or the Lightning platform gives you is called as database.stateful. So this also circles back to my earlier point of introduction to Apex day two, where we were saying that the reason why you implement interfaces is because Apex allows an Apex class to implement multiple interfaces, right? So here we are implementing multiple interfaces. So database.stateful is one such interface. Technically, you don't really have a method that is mandated over here. So an interface may or may not have a method. And because it does not have a method, you don't really have a mandate on enforcing one another method, correct? However, Batchable does have methods which we need to implement as a part of the batch job implementation. So let's go and see how you can actually use Stateful. So Stateful helps us overcome this challenge and it maintains the state of the variables across batches. So circling back to my original example where you were supposed to count the number of leads belonging to a certain state. In this case now, the variable count would not get reset and the value would be persisted, which means you would be able to get the actual count of the records across the execute methods. Okay. And which means that And then in the finish method, you will be able to really say how many times or the actual value of that particular variable that was actually computed in the execution of the execute method right here. So let's just, that brings me on to my second demonstration. So let me quickly demonstrate to you, how can you implement a batch job which maintains the state of the variables in between the batches during an execution of a single batch job. So what I'm going to do is simply, I'm going to switch over to my Salesforce instance right here and then go to the developer console. Within the developer console, I'm going to say a new Apex class because this is going to be an Apex class. And I'm going to say stateful demo. I'm going to name the class stateful demo. I'm going to say okay. And now because I already have some code written over here, I'm going to just go back and paste the code right here. Oops. So I'm going to quickly change the name and then remove the. So what I have here is a simple batch job, a batch Apex class, which of course implements the database.batchable interface. And then in order to ensure that the state between the batches of a batch job is persisted, you need to implement or implement the database.stateful interface. Now, once you have done that, what I really have here is a simple demonstration of the stateful batch job. So I have the usual start, execute, and finish methods, which are a mandate to be implemented because you know, that's something mandated by the database.batchable interface. So what I'm going to do here is typically go and you know, I've written the implementations for my start method, the execute method, and finish method. So the start method has a statement which kind of outputs this particular statement with a debug log. And then there is a query which kind of queries the account records. And now what I'm going to do is I am going to say, okay, my limit of the number of total number of records that I should be able to query is about 100, right? And then what I have a magic number variable, which is an integer type of variable and stores numeric values. Every time the batch job increments, every time the batch job executes, okay, based on the batch size that we've scoped out, and we will see how we can do that. Accordingly, the number of executions of the execute method will occur. Right. So if we, let's say if we have a total of 100 records and we say the batch size to be 50, then there are going to be two batches in the batch job that will be processed, which means there will be the execute method will actually occur twice. Right. Now, with that being said, what I'm trying to do is in every occurrence or in every execution of the execute method, I'm trying to increment the magic number that I have from 1 to 5. So initially, if we saw the magic in the previous example or in my demonstration one, the value of magic number did not change right here because the state was not persisted across the batches. In this case, when I make changes, the state will be persisted and the value will be persisted, which can also be seen in the finish method. So let me just quickly save this class right here. And we are going to go to the execute anonymous window and quickly make a call to this. And the way we're going to do this is I'm going to instantiate the class. And then I am going to make a call to the database.execute batch. And I'm going to pass the instance to this execute batch method. And the second parameter, input parameter to that is the batch size. And I want only 50 records to be processed per batch. So basically what I'm telling the batch job is when the stateful demo batch job executes, what will typically happen is only 50 records will be processed in a single batch. So if you look at the query that is returning, the query will at least return or at max return only 100 records, which means that if I have 100 records and I break it up into one batch of 50 records each that can be processed in a single batch, there will be a total of two batches executed, which means that every time in the first iteration of the invocation of the execute method, the magic number will be set to 5. And in the second execution, it will be set to 10. And finally, when the finish method executes, the value will be, the actual final value should be printed as 10 in the debug log. So let's go and quickly see how this actually works. So I'm going to now go and simply say execute. And once I do that, what has happened is the bad job has gone into the queue. And because bad jobs are asynchronous jobs, they will not execute immediately, right? Now, let me just quickly, in order to check the status of execution for the bad jobs, I'm going to go to my Salesforce instance, go to Apex jobs, and then start searching for the bad job. Now, if I really see in this particular case, there were, because the total number of, there was not really heavy processing required, and the availability of resources were relatively idle, it was really quick and the bad job actually got executed. So if the way you can actually identify that this is your bad job, you can see which class was running as a part of the bad job. So say stateful demo was the class that we created, and that is what ran. It completed. So there were a total of two batches that got completed, and the batches processed successfully were two. So let's go back and check in the debug logs what is the actual value of the magic number that get printed. So I'm going to switch over to my dev console, quickly go to my logs, all right, and let me look at let's start reviewing each of the logs here. So serial batch Apex chunk handler is actually the, so nope, there's nothing printed. Let's see this one, if that's the right log to look at. Okay, so there was a print, which means that the execute method did get executed. And then this is another execution of the execute method, which means two batches are already kind of, so there is one execute method per batch of the bad job, right? And we had two batches, so there will be two methods. Now let's go and see if we can find something here. Okay, so this also does not have anything, which means that this should ideally have something for us to see. And if you see, this is the actual final log which got executed when the batch job executed and the finish method got fired. And if you see, because there were two batches that were executed, right? One execution of execute method per batch, and within each execution of the execute method, the magic number was incremented by 5. Hence the value of the magic number is actually 10, as compared to the earlier demo where the value did not persist across batches. So this is a very simple example of how you can really maintain the state of the variables and continuously record information and persist that through across the batches, and then use that to perform some relevant actions based on the state of those variables in the finish method. With that, I'm going to go back and switch back to my slide deck. Now, there are certain key considerations while you are writing a bad job. At max, there could be 50 million records that could be processed. Try to you know, if you really have the need of batch apex, I mean, if you see that there are more than one batches being processed, then only use a batch job. Otherwise, you could use queueable apex as an option. Make sure that you fine tune your SQL query, because you're already dealing with a large volume, which means that, you know, if you really don't have your SQL query optimized in terms of the query filters and the where clauses, the query locator result set could be huge, which could contain unnecessary records. That just reduces the performance of the overall batch job. You can invoke a batch job from a trigger, but ensure that, you know, you do so very consciously, because every time you create or instantiate a batch job, and when I'm saying instantiate, basically calling the database.execute batch method from the trigger, every time you call, there results in an entry over here, which means there is a job running, and there is a constraint in the total number of jobs that could run simultaneously at a given point in time. So there is a governor limit on that. The last that I remember, that number was 5, but I can confirm that number. So basically, you cannot have 5 batch job, more than 5 batch jobs continuously running, which means that if your trigger fires and if your code is not very optimally written, you could easily breach that limit, and that could result in a limit exception, which could be a problem. And that's the reason why it's mentioned that, you know, when you invoke a batch job from a trigger, it could lead to uncontrolled executions. Just like there is a stateful interface for ensuring the state persists across the batches, there is also an allow callouts. So typically, when you're doing large, heavy data processing and you want to make callouts, you can, by default, callouts are not permitted from a batch job, but you can make that provided you implement the database.allowcallouts interface. So these are some of the key considerations while you write a batch job. Now, with that, we will move to another important aspect of writing, being able to write scheduled jobs. So basically, often there is a need that you want to perform processing, some kind of processing at a predefined interval of time, maybe on a daily basis, or maybe on a monthly basis, or maybe on an hourly basis, right? And this kind of processing can be achieved only via scheduled apex. Of course, you can do that using a workflow or a process builder, but this gives you finer control or programmatic control in terms of what is the extent to which you can schedule your apex code. So that is where scheduled apex comes in handy. Scheduled apex is just typically used for invocation on a scheduled interval of time. Batch jobs are typically used for processing heavy volumes of data. So writing batch apex is, if you want to process really large number of records, technically millions of records, whereas scheduled apex is written to ensure that you can execute your apex code at a specified or given interval of time. Right. So let's just understand how this all works. A lot of this would really seem similar to a batch job execution. The only key change over here, so even a scheduled job is an asynchronous execution, which means the scheduled job does not execute immediately as soon as it is invoked. What you typically do is, as soon as it is invoked, the Apex language runtime takes and puts it into the scheduled job queue, right? And then based on the precedence, right, and the time zone and the time that you have specified as a cron expression, the job is picked up from the queue and then it is further processed. Like a batch job, a scheduled job also has certain terminal states. There could be a success or a partial success in case of some records that could failed and some passed. Aborted is when the scheduled job is explicitly killed, right, via a user interface. And the last but not the least, there is a failure state wherein you had a certain amount of records to process, but unfortunately the job did not go through and it resulted in failures or errors. So this is typically how a scheduled Apex job works. Now let's look at how an Apex job actually, a scheduled Apex job looks like in real. So before that, there's an important concept that I would explain. One of the key things that differentiates a scheduled Apex job from a bad job is the ability to provide a cron expression. Okay, a cron expression is something, is basically a string that you provide, and it has, it takes in basically six values, and each value defines a specific aspect of the cron expression. A cron expression is provided to the scheduled job, which basically tells the scheduled job the periodicity of when the scheduled job should execute. Okay, and each position here corresponds to a specific parameter. In this this table right here explains what that is. So the first is the seconds, the second position, and it could have a value of 0 to 59. The second position is the minutes, the third being the hours, the fourth being the day of the month, which is basically date, and then there is the month and the day of the week. So you can actually go granular and to say that, oh, I wanted to execute on every Wednesday, or you could also specify the year where you could say that I want this job to start running today and end in 2021, right? So you could go to that. These are some of the characters that you could use. If you want to, so asterisk or star is one of the most commonly used characters. It typically depicts that any time, you basically are not specifying. So you could use it for the month, for the day. If you, for example, if you wanted to run every day, you would just put a star in the day of the month value, right? So on and so forth. You can construct n number of combinations of a cron expression, but the cron expression is critical because that is what governs when should your scheduled job execute. Okay, so that is what a cron expression is and how you would construct a cron expression. Don't get bogged down with this number of parameters. You will take some time to understand, but I think it's more semantic in nature. So over a period of time, you just get used to it. So this is how you construct a cron expression, and I'll tell you where and how this cron expression is used. So let's just go and look at the anatomy of a scheduled Apex job. So just like for writing a batch job, you need to implement the database.batchable interface. Similarly, for a scheduled batch job, you need to implement a schedulable interface, right? And this schedulable interface mandates the implementation of an execute method, which means that you need to provide an implementation for the execute method, right? It only provides mandates one method execution. The remaining method, there is no other method that needs to be implemented, unlike in batch jobs where you have to implement three methods, which is start, execute, and finish. So this is how you would define a scheduled job, but there are also ways in which you can invoke a scheduled job explicitly, programmatically. So often there is a need where you want finer control, right? So you can actually define the scheduled job through the schedulable interface, right? And we will see how you can do that. But that interface, which is provided on Salesforce itself, has certain limitations in terms of the granularity of the cron expression that can be, or the granularity of the period at which the job can be scheduled, versus programmatically you can really go down to every minute to schedule. So basically your scheduled job could run at every interval, but on the UI, which is Salesforce provided, you did not have that flexibility. And that's why sometimes using this cron expression gives you greater flexibility or control as compared to the schedule Apex option on the UI. So you basically create a cron job and then use the system.schedule method. Schedule is a static method which belongs to the system class, and it takes basically three parameters, right? The first is basically you just want to uniquely identify your job when you see it in the scheduled Apex console, just like we were seeing Apex jobs. You tell what is the cron expression, because that is going to define the periodicity. And the third is basically the instance of the actual class which implements the schedulable interface. Okay, so this is how you would invoke a scheduled Apex job. That before I kind of go to the demo of the scheduled Apex, I just quickly want to touch base on a few key points. At max, there can be only 100 jobs that can be scheduled concurrently, right? So you got to make sure, and you should be aware of this limit as a developer, because you could, you know, it is easily, you could be misled saying that, oh, I scheduled a job and, you know, it's in the queue, or it, you know, basically you don't have any kind of control, which means there could be a possibility that your same job could have multiple instances, and that could contribute to this 100 job limit, right? So basically 100 scheduled jobs, no more than 100 scheduled jobs can run concurrently on the Apex platform. That's a governor limit that is enforced. There is also a limit on the maximum number of scheduled Apex invocations per 24 hours, and synchronous callouts are not supported from scheduled Apex, which means that, you know, if you're making a web service call and you immediately want the response back in that web service call, you can't really do that from scheduled Apex. Don't worry about the web service callouts. You have an entire session which is dedicated to that, so you'll kind of decipher that in that particular session. But yeah, that's a limitation. So that brings me to demo three, which is about how to go about writing a scheduled job. So let's go switch over to the developer console and see how a scheduled job can be written. So I'm going to switch back to my developer console, close all the classes, and say a new class. I'm going to copy I'm going to name my class schedule demo 3. It's a regular Apex class, but you know, based on the way how a scheduled class needs to be written, I'm implementing a schedulable interface, and I'm providing an implementation for the execute method. I'm just printing a debug statement. It could be more complex, in which you are actually writing logic to iterate over query records, iterate them, and you know, perform some kind of processing, or just make a call to any external class or method. Now, one of the common combinations that are used in the industry is using scheduled jobs and batch jobs together, which means that you could actually invoke a batch job from a scheduled job. That's something which is widely used. So you can do that, and that's perfectly okay. Just make sure that if you are having multiple scheduling instances, you also ensure that you are not hitting the limits in terms of your batch job execution, because that too has limits which are separate. Okay, so but this is most of the times scheduled jobs and batch jobs are used in conjunction. I just commented out this code just to show you that this can be called, right? So I am just going to this class, I'm just going to save this class right here, and then go to the execute anonymous window, and I'm going to make a very explicit call, right? Just like I did a database.execute batch, I'm going to do a system.schedule over here. What I've done is I've created an instance of my class. I've created a cron string variable, and of course I'm going to give it a name. I'm going to just change the name to schedule job demo 1. I have given some time, so I'm going to specify the month and the date, and then I'm going to say execute. I'm going to replace this with star just to see if you know, not put a constraint and just to show you that this works. And then I'm going to say execute. Hopefully this should run. Okay, must be specified as integers. So it says it actually needs integer values. So I'm going to replace this with my original string. So day, month, year, hour, minute, second, seconds, minutes, hours. So 7:20, hopefully this runs. Let me just quickly go back and check the cron expression. Seconds, minutes, hours, day of the month. Okay, for now we just kind of stick to whatever string we have in the interest of time, and I'll just say execute. So definitely the job went inside the queue. It might take a while before the job executes, but we can definitely go and monitor a scheduled job. So you need to go back to your Salesforce instance and look, type in the keyword again, jobs. Now this time, instead of the Apex jobs, we'll use the refer to the scheduled jobs monitoring queue, right? So if you see, there is an entry, right? And it says scheduled job demo one. Right now this has been submitted, but it has not been started. It is a scheduled Apex, right? So this is basically how, it creates an entry. Now, because of the cron expression, it may not run immediately, right? But once it runs, it would basically create a debug log, and you know, it would write the value to the system.debug. So this is typically how a scheduled job can be written and can be invoked. I'll quickly switch back to my slide deck. So this is how you can write a scheduled job. There are some great resources that you can refer to. Of course, there are custom iterators, so you might at some point in time, when you want to refer to advanced concepts, custom iterators could be a reference from the Apex developer guide. You could also look at understanding the execution governor limits, because that is an important aspect of understanding how to use batch jobs and scheduled jobs, right? Last but not the least, there is of course Trailhead. So you can, there's a detailed Trailhead module on understanding async Apex, and also on it not only covers batch and schedulers, but it also covers the future and the queueable, which unfortunately I was not able to cover today. We'll try to see if we can, you know, add that to the recording later. But yeah, that's the this particular Trailhead batch gives you all the details around that. I think with that, I come to the the assignment for today. So today's assignment is very straightforward. You need to write a batch job that runs daily at 9 p.m. local time and searches for the newly created accounts for that day. The job then basically sums the amount field on every opportunity for all opportunities associated with that account, and updates the total value, the summation value, on the respective pipeline amount field on the respective parent account record of those opportunities, right? There's a hint here which says assume pipeline amount field to be a custom currency field created on account, which means technically you might have to create that and use a combination of scheduled and batch jobs to achieve the desired functionality. So hopefully you guys should be able to write and complete this assignment. Fairly straightforward. We would love to hear back from you on this. And with that, I'd open up the floor for questions. I'm sure there are a lot of questions, and we've been seeing that in the chat window. But yeah, any open questions, I'll be more than happy to answer. Okay. I'm just going to quickly pause the sharing and quickly go back and see if there are any open questions. So there is one question which says, why is that cron expression not a date time variable? Unfortunately, that is something that we do not control. That is something which has been defined and designed by the platform. So that is the reason why you cannot really directly use a date time string. However, you can use a date time string and separate out the values, because when you write a date time, you can use that to separate out the values and then use those values, individual variables, in your cron expression, so that you could still do that. All right, so that's one of the reasons one of the ways in which you can leverage a date time variable, but it still has to be a cron expression, which is either mentioned in a static manner or which is defined at runtime basis some date time variable values. Okay. All right.
Jigar, there is a one question. Probably you can you can answer that. So The question is, what is the role of assign to the batch in running user? So basically, what will happen when we run a batch in a particular user context versus running a batch in a system context?
Okay. All right. So basically what happens is, that's a great question actually. So basically the difference between a user context and a system context is very straightforward. When you say system context, the code runs with complete full privileges or elevated privileges, which means that the code, it is almost like an admin being able to access the complete data, which means that your query results could retrieve all the records available on the in the object that you're querying on, right? Or it could return more records, because your code is basically, when your code runs in system mode, it's running with elevated permissions, right? Unfortunately, that is not how your code should be running. Your code should be running in the user context, which means the code should be capable of understanding the context of the user and respect, or should be able to only retrieve that kind of data which it is authorized to do so. And that is the reason why you can actually use with sharing in some of in your class definitions, right? When you declare a class, you can either prefix it with sharing or without sharing. So when you say with sharing, the class knows that this class needs to run in the user context, which means it will not run with elevated privileges, and it will only run in the context of the user executing that code, right? Which means that it will not be able to access those records which it was not supposed to from a security configuration standpoint. So that is the key or the fundamental difference between running in a system mode versus running in a user mode. All right. Hopefully that answers your question. There's a question from Ria. This is the last question, unfortunately, for the day. It says that, but a scheduled class has limits that it cannot do web service callouts, but it can call batch class which is implementing web service callouts. Yeah, you typically, even in a batch job, you cannot make web service callouts directly. You need to implement the database.allow callouts interface. That is what enables you to make web service calls. Okay. Don't really get bogged down about the web service thing, because you have a complete session planned. It was just a thing that I wanted to bring to your notice. But yeah, you cannot directly make immediate runtime, synchronous web service calls within a scheduled job, because scheduled job itself is asynchronous. And that is the reason why they restrict you from doing that. So, all right. Having said that, the recording will be uploaded soon. Thank you so much for being such a wonderful and patient audience. I really appreciate all the questions and all the enthusiastic comments that I keep getting on the chat window. If we are not able to answer some of your questions, feel free to post them on the blog, and we'll do our best to answer those questions. A quick thank you to all the co-organizers who are on the session right now. Takes a lot of effort to stay focused and answer the huge inflow of questions that keep coming in. So Purushottam, thank you, and all the other co-organizing team who's there on the call right now, big thank you to you guys. So until then, until tomorrow, goodbye, good morning, good night, based on wherever, whatever time zone you're located in. Keep learning and keep blazing new trails. We'll be signing off for now, and we will back tomorrow with an interesting session. Tomorrow's going to be a session around web services. So please do not miss that. It's going to be a very important topic. So thank you once again. Bye. Have a good day.